Good evening. I got to put my own mic back on here. That's the sound of God. Okay. Dan, thank you. Bill planted this. Bill did this. I want to thank Dan for a great introduction. I appreciate that. Dan wrote one of the best third semester projects I think I've ever had in 13 or 14 years of doing MFA programs. I also like to thank Sonia and Bill and all the faculty, and Elizabeth especially, for putting together another great residency. What I thought I'd do tonight is read from a new novel. There are our books in the bookstore. It's their pre-ARC copies. And just a little bit about the book. I've read a couple of sections from this novel earlier. And it's about a 51-year-old woman in Connecticut who's lost her adult son, and she goes on a cross-country journey to find out what happened to him in his death. And along the way, she runs across what are called descansos, or resting places, roadside memorials. I'm going to read the prologue and the first chapter from this novel. It'll be about 25 minutes, and I'll be glad to open up to questions and answers. And for my students in the novel workshop tomorrow, please make sure you have some questions. I want you to grill me, because I'll be grilling you tomorrow. And this is from the prologue of Resting Places. The summer Luke was five, they had gone on vacation to the British Isles. After spending a week touring London, they'd taken the train to Fishguard, Wales, for a nighttime ferry crossing to Rosslare, Ireland. During the train ride, the three of them had played games like rock, paper, scissors, and the find it game, where the first person to spot something passing by in the countryside, a cow, a steeple, one of those red phone booths, won. They were going to spend another week traveling around Ireland, stopping along the way in Tralee, where Elizabeth's father had been born. Her father had passed away a few years before, and his death had left Elizabeth with a jagged hole in her heart. Suddenly, she felt herself drawn to her roots, and she wanted Luke to remember her grandfather. "That's Poppy," she explained to her son, showing the black and white photo in her purse. It was of a tall, good-looking, raven-haired young man in a seersucker suit standing in front of Sean Ogue's pub in Tralee. Elizabeth had always been told she was a spitting image of her father, tall, with that dark hair and a broad mouth. "He's dead," her son said. "Yes, sweetie, Poppy's dead. But we're going to see where he was born. He was little like me?" "At one time, yes." Weary as they got off the train well past midnight, they lugged their suitcases through a cool, oddly bluish drizzle toward a small cafe and gift shop along the wharf to await boarding. Inside, they dropped their bags, and Zach leaned in and kissed her. "This is going to be fun," he said. Glancing over Zach's shoulder, she asked, "Where's Luke?" "He was right here." They hurried back to the train, began searching up and down the aisle of the car they'd been in. Trying to reassure her, Zach touched her shoulder, and with that engineer's pragmatic approach to any problem, he calmly said, "Don't worry, we'll find him." Of course they would, she told herself. Wasn't this just like Luke to wander off when she turned her head for a moment in the mall, a crowded airport, at the beach? Sometimes she thought Luke did it on purpose, an only child vying for the attention of his busy professional mother. "Luke," Elizabeth called in a fluttery voice, at first mimicking those restrained British tones. But then, as the seconds ticked by, louder, more urgently, she called, "Luke, honey, Luke!" When he didn't turn up on the train, they hurried outside, searching among the growing crowd of people assembling for the ferry crossing. As the uneasy seconds spiraled quickly into terrifying minutes, Elizabeth kept telling herself that Luke would show up any second, as he always did. She told herself that everything would return to normal, and they'd board the ferry and continue on with their vacation. "Wait till I get a hold of that little stinker," she even told herself, trying to make light of the whole thing. But then she happened to catch the expression on the face of her normally unflappable husband. It was a stiff mask of barely withheld dread. That startled her. If Zach was scared, then something must be serious. At that point, there was an announcement over the loudspeaker telling people they could begin boarding the ferry. This was followed by a sudden surge of damp bodies en masse toward the ramp. Elizabeth and Zach felt themselves being lifted up as if on a wave and carried along toward the ship. In such chaos, she thought, how could they ever hope to find Luke? Her mind quickly bounded over all the other possibilities and went straight for the worst, the blackest prospect. What if at that moment their son was being abducted and whisked away? Or what if he had fallen into the murky sea, his little body floating face down in the harbor? This line of thinking carried its own inexorable logic. A lawyer used to arranging facts in a line of causation, she began working out the implications of Luke's disappearance. Having described her son to the local authorities, age, height, weight, the color of his eyes, a grayish blue sort of, what he was wearing, she couldn't remember. The tiny scar beneath his chin he'd gotten from a fall when he was 2, her fault as well. Canceling the rest of their vacation, after a certain interim having to imagine the unimaginable plane ride home, just her and Zach, the empty seat between them, mocking their loss, followed eventually by wondering what she'd do with Luke's things back in Connecticut, his clothes, his toys, his entire bedroom. And finally, picturing the interminable days that would stretch out in front of her and Zach to the end of time, and all without their little Lukey. One moment they were a happy little family, and the next everything had been ruined, like that. But suddenly her mood changed from fear to anger. She'd be damned if she was going to let this happen. No, she was Luke's mother, and she'd move heaven and earth to find him. She would do anything. Luke, she cried out with renewed vigor, abandoning finally the last vestiges of restraint or dignity, no longer caring in the least how absurd she must appear to those around her, this loudmouth, hysterical American parent. She left Zach and ran through the crowd, jostling people, shoving her way past, all the while crying out her son's name, nearly knocking down one man with a cane. What in the bloody hell, lady? She frantically made her way through the crowded wharf. Finally, she stopped, spun around, her eyes darting this way and that, the pulse pounding in her neck. Then, beginning as a frail, almost inaudible whisper, a voice rose in her head, a voice that was both hers and that of a complete stranger. It was something she hadn't done, not in years anyway, something that wasn't part of her normally pragmatic, rational makeup. Elizabeth was 36 years old, someone who hadn't been to church since she'd gone off to college, who hadn't spoken a word to God once in all that time. Yet she now found herself offering up a plea somewhere within the darkened corridors of her mind. Please, God, don't let anything happen to my baby. Seconds passed. Finally, Zach was at her side, his arm around her shoulder. It'll be okay, he said, squeezing her. Later, she wouldn't be able to explain why or how, what made her think of it, but she took Zach's hand and rushed with him toward the cafe. Inside, standing in front of a display of touristy trinkets, was Luke. He was completely mesmerized by some toy he was playing with, twirling the thing back and forth in front of his face. Seeing him alive and whole and unhurt, Elizabeth felt herself finally exhale the breath she hadn't known she'd been holding, the sour feeling of dread passing from her lungs. The entire ordeal lasted perhaps only 10 minutes, but it was the most frightening, most defining 10 minutes of Elizabeth's life. When he saw his parents, Luke came rushing up. Can I get this, Mom? He was holding out a small toy in his hand. Squatting, Elizabeth grabbed her son roughly by his narrow shoulders and had to fight the urge to shake him silly. Don't ever do that again, she yelled, tears springing to her face. You scared Mommy. As tears welled up in Luke's eyes as well, she came to her senses and hugged him desperately, fiercely, squeezing him so hard he cried out, Mom, geez, you're hurting. After a while, she saw what it was that Luke held. In his palm sat a tiny toy airplane, a die-cast model of a British Spitfire, so small it could fit in the palm of his hand. Taking after his father, Luca developed an obsession for model airplanes. He loved collecting them, displaying them on a shelf, hanging them by fishing line from the ceiling. Of course, she thought, she bought the thing for him. She'd have bought 1,000 toys, anything to show her gratitude. Zach bent down and wrapped his arms around his wife and son. "Didn't I tell you it would be all right?" Feeling suddenly grateful, as if they'd been granted a second chance at happiness. Elizabeth grasped Luke's face and kissed him. "I love you," she said. "I love you too, but we better get going or we'll miss the boat." They hurried out and boarded the ferry and carried on with their vacation. Elizabeth tried hard to push the near tragedy of that moment from her thoughts. As they toured Ireland, with Zach stressing out every time they came to a roundabout, and Luke in the back making zoo-zoo flying noises with his toy airplane, she tried to enjoy herself, tried to forget what might have happened. But she couldn't, not completely, not in Ireland, nor later on the plane ride home, nor in fact in all their subsequent years together. In fact, she couldn't hear the word whales or see that airplane on Luke's shelf back home without it conjuring up that dark memory, that moment of unholy terror of a mother facing the loss of her child. Nor could she avoid the nagging vulnerability that would plague the rest of her days, knowing as she did that in that blink of an eye, everything could change like that. Chapter 1. Elizabeth had just gotten off the phone when the timid knock sounded on her office door. She'd hoped to have a little time to collect her thoughts, but before she could answer, the door opened a crack and a slight, haggard-looking woman, more girl than woman, poked her head in. Her blackened eyes reminded Elizabeth of a raccoon. "Pardon usted, Señor Elizabeth," the woman asked meekly. "Is time now?" "Un momento, por favor," she said to the woman. The woman withdrew and shut the door. Elizabeth sat there for a moment, trying to regulate her breathing, hoping to get herself together enough to deal with someone else's problems. Sometimes she felt like an actor who had to put aside her own life to assume that of the character she was playing. She'd sensed a growing annoyance on the part of Sheriff Crowder, the man with whom she'd just gotten off the phone. "I told you, ma'am, we already sent you all his personal effects." "But I'm sure he had it with him." "It's not here. Could you just humor me and look again?" "We don't have it, Mrs. Gerlacher," the sheriff said flatly. "Did you even..." But before she could finish, he cut her off. "I have to go, ma'am. Goodbye." "Fuck," she cursed, slamming her palm down so hard on the flimsy dinette table that it spilled some of the coffee from a cup. This made the fifth or sixth time she called the Marizozo, New Mexico Sheriff's Department in the last few months. Not only about the missing diary, but also discuss other things in the police report. Things that didn't make sense, that didn't add up. Each time she called, the sheriff seemed to get more defensive. And each time, growing increasingly desperate for answers, Elizabeth had become more pugnacious, allowing her cross-examination behavior to leech into her normally civil demeanor. Finally, she got up and went to the door and opened it. Peering out into the hallway of the annex of the small chapel, Elizabeth saw the woman sitting on the floor, her feet curled up Buddha style beneath her. She appeared as anxious looking as an eighth grader waiting to speak to a teacher about a bad grade. The last time Elizabeth had seen her, nearly a week before, the rawness of her bruised, swollen eyes had taken Elizabeth's breath away, but the swelling had gone down considerably. And now the gaudy yellows and purples looked more like some teenager's idea of a makeup statement. "Come in, Fabiana," Elizabeth said. The young woman entered and sat down opposite Elizabeth. She was wearing a Mets baseball cap, a flannel shirt that hadn't been washed in a while, and torn, loose jeans. She kept both hands over her distended belly, holding it like a football player guarding against a fumble in the last minutes of a game. "Cómo está?" asked Elizabeth, opening her file on the desk. "Bien, good." "And your eyes? Oh, your ojos?" Elizabeth said, touching her own eyes. Nodding, the woman replied, "Better, no hurt." "And how is," Elizabeth asked, patting her own flat stomach, "the baby?" "Sí, el baby es bien, kicking," she said with a smile. For the past few years, Elizabeth had been doing pro bono work at the Mystic Women's Shelter, a couple of afternoons a week and sometimes on Saturdays. The shelter was part of a Catholic retreat on a small island off the coast of eastern Connecticut. The cramped space Father Paul, the director, provided Elizabeth as a part-time office was actually an all-purpose room, containing the copier, a coffee machine, an apartment-sized refrigerator, a tag sale kitchen set with cracked vinyl seats. It was also where Father Paul, or simply Paul as he preferred, hung his vestments in the corner. On one wall was a picture of John Lee Hooker, Father Paul's favorite blues guitarist, while on the opposite wall was one of Jesus feeding the 5,000. Loaves of bread and fishes appeared to fall from the sky, a downpour of food. Elizabeth helped women with legal matters, began divorce proceedings, sued for child support or alimony, or sometimes defended them against crimes like theft or drug possession, or like now, to guide them through the intricacies of filling out a restraining order. Unlike in her law firm, where she worked mostly with affluent, middle-class people, her clients at the shelter were mostly poor white or women of color, or like Fabiana, recent immigrants. Fabiana journeyed from Honduras 2 years earlier, and when she related the complex story of how she got to the U.S., Elizabeth could only shake her head and say, "Jesus." There were no translators, so Elizabeth had to rely on her rusty high school Spanish and hand gestures to communicate. Elizabeth began helping the woman fill out the restraining order, which was intended to keep her boyfriend from beating her up again. "What that means," Fabiana asked Elizabeth, "ex parte, that means we're asking the court for immediate relief from the respondent, KS respondent, that's your boyfriend, Jorge." Fabiana stared down at her lap. Elizabeth felt that if not for the fading bruises around her eyes and a depleted look that belied her 19 years, Fabiana would have been pretty. She had lucid acorn-colored eyes, a generous mouth, lustrous skin the hue of burnished leather, and long auburn hair she kept in a tight braid down her back. Her fingernails were chipped and dirty from the per diem work Father Paul had arranged for on a local farm sorting carrots and potatoes. Even from across the table, Elizabeth could smell the sour sweat and farm odor of her body. The woman's son, Esteban, too, was at that moment playing with a half dozen other kids in the shelter's nursery, several doors down. Occasionally, Elizabeth could hear a gleeful cry or a wail of disappointment emanating from down the hall. Sometimes, when Elizabeth wasn't busy, she'd go down to the nursery and get down on the floor and play with the kids. Fabiana's Esteban was adorable. "I know can see him?" the woman asked. Against the brown skin of her neck, Elizabeth spotted a silver crucifix. "He know can see you," Elizabeth replied almost harshly. "Cuánto tiempo?" "That will depend." "On what?" "On a lot of things, mostly what the court decides in his case." "Will he have to go to La Caselle?" "Prison," Elizabeth knew. "Yes, but only if you testify. Comprendes? Testificar?" The woman shook her head vigorously. "What do you mean? You have to testify. Look what he did to you." "I no want him to go away to La Caselle. Next time it might be worse. You have to think of your unborn child, su baby," she said, patting her own stomach again. "Jorge, he's good man. He just get un poco loco when he drink. But you have to press charges and you have to take out this restraining order. We need to make sure he stays away from you. If you don't want to do it for yourself, do it for Esteban, for your baby. Jorge, love Esteban. And he es padre de baby," the woman said, pointing at her stomach. "He no hurt them." Elizabeth stared at her. "But he's capable of that. You must do this, Fabiano." "Lo siento. I'm sorry." The woman waved her hand in front of her face as if you're brushing away a bad smell. "I can't help you if you don't let me," Elizabeth said, her anger and frustration slipping into her voice. Elizabeth didn't understand such women. Women who were abused, who were used as punching bags for her husband's or boyfriend's frustrations and angers, who still somehow loved them. But that wasn't really love, she thought. That was need or fear or guilt or something else entirely, but not love. Love couldn't grow in such unfertile soil. I know, Fabiana said, tears beginning to run down her bruised cheeks. You so good to me, Signor Elizabeth. Lo siento. Despite being annoyed with her, Elizabeth got up and went around the table. She squatted down and put her arms around the woman. Fabiano's sobs convulsed her small body. She clutched onto Elizabeth like a frightened child. It's all right, Fabiano, Elizabeth said, rubbing the woman's back in small circles. She was so skinny, Elizabeth could feel the vertebrae along the woman's spine. As she stroked her, she recalled when Luke was small and crying about something or other, holding him and quieting his fears. It's all right, sweetie, everything's all right. At least promise me you'll think about filling out the restraining order. You have at least to do that. See, the woman said, I think about it. Elizabeth stood, suggesting to the woman it was time to leave, that she had done all she could for her. The rest would be up to her. At the door, she turned and said, Signor Elizabeth, you are a good woman. Gracias. You think about it, Fabiano, for both your children. Elizabeth was sitting at the table doing some paperwork and imagining how sweet that first scotch was going to taste when Father Paul stuck his bald, narrow head in the door. How's Perry Mason today? I guess I'm dating myself with that, he said with a boyish grin. You're not that much older than me. When I was a little girl, I used to watch the reruns with my father. Ah, the Irishman. As Irish as Paddy's pig, she said with a laugh. She told Paul about her father. Though she didn't go to church herself anymore, she'd had Paul say a mass for the man. It was something her father would have appreciated. He loved how Raymond Burr always got the bad guys in the last 2 minutes, she explained. Paul said, virtue always rewarded, sin punished. What a perfect world. Father Paul was thin, with a shaved head and the sharp lupine face of a fox. His countenance was softened a bit by sad-looking basset hound eyes. Eyes were perpetually pink from doing laps without goggles in the overchlorinated YMCA pool in town. As usual, he wasn't wearing a collar, but rather cargo pants, a ratty old sweater he bought when he was in the Aran Islands on an archaeological dig involving the 7 ancient churches. Elizabeth and Paul would talk about Ireland, the places Elizabeth's father had gone. A brilliant man, Father Paul possessed a bushel full of advanced degrees and spoke a dozen languages. Unfortunately, we don't always get the bad guys, Paul, she said, rolling her eyes conspiratorially at the priest. You mean Fabiana's boyfriend? Uh-huh. She wouldn't sign the restraining order. Now she's not sure she wants to testify against our boy, Jorge. She doesn't want him to go to La Carcel. She's a very feeling woman, or a very foolish one, Elizabeth said. It's not always a bad thing to turn the other cheek. It is when you know the other cheek is going to get itself smacked. Father Paul came in and sat down across from her. He ran his hand over the top of his shiny, bald skull. His shaved head reminded Elizabeth of a newborn, soft and vulnerable. You don't know that for sure. I'm willing to bet on it, Elizabeth said. All right. What? He asked, extending his hand across the table. What do you mean, what? I'm willing to bet he's learned his lesson. All right. How about a bottle of scotch? I'm not much of a scotch man, he said. How about if I lose, I buy you a bottle? But if you lose, you come to work here. Elizabeth let out with a chuckle. Now that seems like a fair deal. I can't match your salary, but you've got this nice plush office with an ocean view, he said, grinning. When he grinned, he looked even more like a fox. The first couple of times he'd asked her to come to work here, his tone had almost been playful. And each time she treated it as a joke she thought it was. But recently he told her that the shelter had gotten a large federal grant and that he actually had the money to pay her, though far from what she was currently making. Of course, she already had a job, a junior partner in a law firm 20 miles away. She liked Father Paul. He was smart and worldly, well-educated, with a good sense of humor. And she liked that he wasn't preachy. His faith wasn't Sunday morning spiel, but rather a way of life. He talked like a regular guy about jazz or sports, history or politics, but he let his actions speak for him. He'd set up this island retreat for battered women and their children, raising money by the seat of his pants, twisting the arms of donors, cajoling or embarrassing them, and often spending his own money on food and toys for the kids. He was a good salesman, too, getting people to donate their money or time or expertise to the cause, like Elizabeth. "You're so good with women," like Fabiana, Paul said. "Now you're giving me a snow job. What's next? You're going to try to sell me some indulgences? Then again, I could probably use some." "No, you are. You obviously have a gift. The only gift I have is that I'm a lawyer, and I don't like some dirtbag who's beating around someone like Fabiana. It's more than that with you. You get satisfaction from working here." It was true, though. She did enjoy working with these women, seeing that they got at least a semblance of legal representation. Despite the annoyances and frustrations like with Fabiana, she felt that her time and effort here made a difference, sometimes a big one. It was, in fact, one of the few things which gave meaning to her life lately. She not only provided legal counsel, but also helped women get social services, food stamps, daycare. Sometimes she even sat with them and helped them learn to read and write. At the same time, she'd begun to find the work at a law firm increasingly tedious. Wills and divorces, prenups and LLCs, defending spoiled little rich kids against DUIs and possession charges. In fact, she'd been spending so much time at the shelter lately, she let her regular job slide, so much so that Warren Fuller, the senior partner, had had to call her into his office on a couple of occasions to speak to her. "And how are you, Elizabeth?" Father Paul asked, his expression what she could imagine it to be in the confessional, thoughtful, considerate, patient. She looked across at him. "Fine," she said. "That's your default reply. How are you really? What do you want me to say?" Paul sat there for a moment, his fingertips forming a little teepee that he tapped against his nose. "It takes time," he offered. "As in time heals all wounds?" "Something like that," he said. He continued staring at her, his pink eyes slick and painful looking. Elizabeth stood, started to pack her briefcase. "Getting over something like this does take time, Elizabeth." "No offense, Father, but how the hell would you know something like this?" she said more harshly than she had intended. She was obviously still annoyed by the phone call earlier. When he looked over at her, she saw the effect it had. He looked snubbed. "Forgive me, Father, I had no right to say that." "No, no, it's all right. Besides, I have the hide of a rhino," he said with a smile. "With this job, you have to be thick-skinned. And you're right, I can't possibly know what it is to lose a child. But I have suffered loss. You can't be human without suffering loss, Elizabeth." She was going to say this was different, that there was no loss in the world like this, but she decided to say nothing at all. "If you'd ever like to pray with me, Elizabeth." "Thanks for the offer, but I don't think so." "Well, I'll pray for you and your son anyway. Is there anything new in your son's case?" "I guess nobody but me thinks of it as a case," Elizabeth said, using her fingers to make quotation marks around the word. "I don't know if I told you this before, but Luke had a diary." "Really? I think it was with him when he was killed." "And you believe that's relevant?" "It wasn't among his things they sent me later. I've called the sheriff down in Mexico several times asking for it, but he says they never had it." "How would that be important?" Father asked. "Who knows? You're thinking it might give you some insight into what he was feeling then?" "It couldn't hurt," Elizabeth replied. She finished packing her briefcase and snapped it shut. Then she grabbed her umbrella and started for the door. "Well, keep in mind my suggestion." "Which one?" Elizabeth said with a smile. "The job," he replied. "We couldn't pay you nearly what you're making, but what a view, huh?" he said, looking out at the ocean. The day was rainy and blustery, the sound full of angry whitecaps. Only a single lobster boat braved the rough waters. "Drive carefully," he said. "It's pretty bad out there." As she headed out, she saw Fabiano in the back of the small chapel. Elizabeth paused, unseen, for a moment. The younger woman had lit a candle and was praying. Elizabeth hadn't been to church since her college days, yet as she watched Fabiano, her head bowed and her eyes tightly shut, Elizabeth found herself longing for such simplicity. She thought of Father Paul's offer to pray with her. She thought, too, of how fervently her own father used to pray in church, his head bowed, his knuckles white from his tightly folded hands. As well, she thought of that time in Wales when they'd lost Luke, of the prayer she had offered to God. She had prayed that time, and like some sort of magic trick, her son had reappeared. If only it were that easy, she thought. Thank you. I'll be glad to entertain questions. Why is everybody on the left side this time? That's the first question I want. Jenny. I have to remember three questions. Why a woman? Several of my books are from a woman's point of view. Why I go back and forth from historical to contemporary. I think I've written, this is my seventh novel, and four of them are contemporary. My short stories are contemporary. So I go back and forth. I say this to my writing students, that you want to follow your nose, follow your interest, whatever you find interesting. And the third question, the middle one, why a woman, why?
Just have the story come to you.
Yeah, I was going to mention this in the novel workshop tomorrow. It came, I was traveling in New England, and I happened to see one of those resting places, one of those crosses. They call them descansos, or resting places, or roadside memorials. And I saw one, and I saw another, and I saw, we all have, okay? And somewhere in the back of my mind, I said, geez, wouldn't that be an interesting story about these crosses? And the first one I actually stopped at was up in New Hampshire. And I pulled over, I had been by it many, many times. How many people have stopped at a roadside memorial? A couple, okay. What's wrong with the rest of you? No, and I had never stopped. And I stopped and I pulled over. And it was a very, a back road, but kind of busy. And I had to jump over the fence, the railing, and I went up to it, and I read, and there was all these things that I read on the side of the cross and around the cross, and statements, and it was a man, and a middle-aged man who obviously had children, a mother, and I read, and it really told a story. And then the second one I saw was on exit 81 or 82 coming east, coming east on 95. If you go from right before New London, there are two crosses on the side of the road. And those are the second crosses I stopped at. This is probably 4 or 5 years ago. And there's a high fence, and I had to jump over the fence, and I went up to it. And it was a boyfriend-girlfriend, as far as I could tell, who had died at this point. And there was all these little symbols and so on. And I said, what a story. And it sat in the back of my mind. Yeah. Yes? That's a good point. Prologues. I had prologues in several of my books. I'm a prologue kind of guy, I guess. I don't know. And they always come later. And I know some writers say, you know, don't write a prologue because it's sort of adding on. Okay, there's a trick to writing a prologue, and I don't always have it down. But you got to sort of tell something, but not tell too much. And sometimes looking backwards. This is actually before the story happens. And then it sort of sets up what's going to happen in this story. Some prologues I've written happens after the story and looking back on. And that one's kind of tricky because you don't want to tell too much. Prologues are things that, you know, for me, in some novels work well, other novels don't work well. You know. I'm sorry?
Does the story have to be complete without the prologue?
This story? Yeah, I think it could be complete. I remember my first novel I wrote was A Brother's Blood, and there was a 5-page journal, and that's formed the prologue in a sense, but it wasn't, and it was the only part of the entire novel that wasn't from Libby Pelletier's point of view. It was a first-person novel, and it was outside of her point of view, outside of her perspective, outside of her knowledge, and it was a journal that a German POW in America kept. And I remember when it was accepted for publication, and I'm usually a pretty flexible writer with editors, you know, if they make a good case, I'll go along with it. They'll just not go too far, right? But in this case, I said, no, this needs to stay there. I had to stay there. So sometimes a prologue is necessary. Other times it's added on. I hope this is necessary. So, yes.
So, yeah, so
Are you talking about prologue?
You can go straight to chapter 1, because that's actually something I consider.
Well, I mean, I think you for everybody here, I think we're asking this question not about this book, but about your own books, and I think every person here as a writer has to decide whether a prologue is necessary. Well, I don't know. I remember in speaking about audiences and modern audiences, Norman Mailer was on Terry Gross one time about 10 years ago. And the first question was, Mr. Mailer, you write such long novels. And he said, that's the stupidest question I've ever been asked. And that's not a stupid question. What I'm saying is that he was talking about attention spans of audience. And then she went on to say, well, you know, most people don't have the attention span to read an 800-page novel. He said, then don't read my novels, okay? You raise a good question. I don't know. I think, you know, sometimes you have to be careful.
I think they are necessary, and so I'm not, like, criticizing the concept of choosing one.
Yeah, and I think
so.
You raise a great question. The whole notion of a prologue is allows you to have a chapter that is well beyond the novel in terms of time, or well before the novel, okay, without you having to explain, you know, what goes on between the first. You raise a great question. I'm talking about Mailer and attention spans here. I think you need to look at the individual novel. Prologues can be very good. Sure.
Yeah. I'm curious about the process of doing that Spanish dialogue in the story or like that.
I get focused on that more over here. Okay. Can you guys hear me? I don't speak Spanish. I have a couple years of Spanish. I'm writing German now, and I don't speak German. I go to people, and my wife is fluent in Spanish, so she went over. I write on a computer 95% of the time. The only time I use a pen is if I'm here at the residency and I'm writing and I don't have a computer with me. I take notes. I take lots of notes with pen. But I write almost all my stuff on the laptop.
Okay. He's reaching for my flask.
Hold that. Can't walk away from the mic.
Okay. Oh, we're doing this thing. That's right. This took me about 3.5 years. But I did other things. I got most of another novel done.
And so. Is it the same publisher for all your books?
No, this is a small publisher. My other ones have been HarperCollins, St. Martin's. This is a small press called Open Books in Bloomington, Indiana. It's called Resting Places, and it's for sale. Yes.
How did you make the decision to start the novel where it began, in chapter one, instead of someplace where, you know, she finds out that her son has died? What was the thought process to start it weeks later?
The prologue and the first chapter, going back to your question, were written later. There was another first chapter that I didn't like and I cut out and started with the prologue in the first chapter. And then there's this other longer thing that I've read a couple times here. That was chapter 2, I think. But I've read it a couple times, so I didn't read it. So, other questions? Yes?
Was pacing kind of an issue for you trying to figure out what information to reveal to the audience at a certain time?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Pacing. Pacing is crucial with any novel. The new novel I'm just about finishing up is set in 1936, another historical novel. A guy's a runner, middle distance, Jewish
middle distance runner, and he goes to compete in the Olympics in 1936. And how much do you tell? And when do you tell his backstory, which is crucial to his story? When do you get that across? You know, I normally tell students who are writing and using backstory, slow down on the backstory. When we as writers, we want to get it all out. We want to get all the stuff out. And if we front load a lot of the information, it slows it down. I tell my students, get the story going, okay? And what I tried to do here, both in the prologue, is to give you some context with that short 3 or 4 page prologue, and then jump into where she is now. And the jump between the two things, her child was momentarily dead, then resurrected, and then, as the first chapter implies, he's dead again by something. And then hopefully that'll pull you into the story. And then the backstory of what happened is interwoven with her story forward, and she goes on a cross-country trip to find it. So pacing is very important. Yes? Louder? The what?
From the introduction
in Ireland. Right. I've been to Galway and Dingle many, many times. And one of my books, a couple of chapters, Garden Martyrs, is a couple of chapters is set there. So you draw on that. And maybe some of you notice that island sounds a little bit like the island. So I stole this. Okay. Yes. Well, she's a woman who's lost a child, okay? And I gave a lecture some time ago about the importance of the empathetic imagination, okay? Now, we can't experience everything that we write about, but we have to write about it anyway, and so we have to use our empathetic. So I knock on wood that I haven't lost a child, but I have had brothers who've lost child, we know friends who've lost children, and so on and so forth. So Elizabeth is going through a very tough time, and she has lost a child, she's estranged from her husband, and she's got all these questions about his death, her son's death. There's a lot of open questions, so there's a part mystery to the story, and she's calling the sheriff because it was a clear day, he wasn't drunk, there was no alcohol involved, there was some other things, and she's questioning what happened. And so what she does, and I'll sort of jump ahead, and this is not a spoiler alert, but I'll jump ahead. She goes cross country, going to the places he stopped, and she follows his charge card, and she follows his phone calls, and she follows where he went to try to find answers. The answers she gets are not the answers she thought she was going to get. It was this, it was that, it was the other thing. So she learns some things that aren't about the case. She learns stuff about herself and about her child, some hopefully remarkable stuff that aren't about the mystery of his death, which is part of what sets her off. Other questions? Yes?
Well, I have a friend who's, very interested in photography. And she asked me, well, isn't there something to collaborate on? Because, you could write, I could take pictures or whatever. And I thought, well, why don't you take pictures of the roadside memorials? And then I could do some research and provide a caption about who that person was. And she called the idea morbid. And so, I don't know, I guess the question is, did you find yourself sort of veering away from the one you did it, or did you, were there ones that were just too, let's say, one story where, but too painful to write about? Or?
Well, I think as writers, if we don't write about painful stuff, we're not doing our job. It's as simple, and depending on how painful we want it to be, I think there's more than just pain in this novel. But to your other question about the research, I did drive cross country, and I took hundreds of pictures of crosses all the way. And as you go south and southwest, you see more and more of these things, They're everywhere. You can't go a mile without seeing a descansos, a resting place. And I read books about it, and I have about maybe 200 pictures. And I originally thought of doing this as a nonfiction piece, because every place you stop, there's a story. I'll just tell you one story that I stopped with my friend. He's a novelist too, and we went across country. And we stopped and we saw these two crosses, and I use it in the book. We saw these two crosses. I have a picture of it. There's a big cross and a little cross. And most of the crosses that you come across have the first name, last name, and date, and the date of birth and date of death. And sometimes they'll have other things like REP or love mother and father or something like this. So I looked at these two crosses. We looked at these two crosses in Arkansas. And there was a name on the bigger cross, full name, and then on the little cross, there was just a first name. And on the big cross, there was a birth date and a death date, about 21 years old, as I recall. And on the little cross, there was only a death date. So we're looking at it, and we're saying, what the heck is that? What's going on? And suddenly, a light up went off in a man's head. A woman would get this right away, right? She was pregnant when she hit this tree and died right here. And her child had never been born, but she was named. And I said, my goodness, what a story this is. Now, is that morbid? I don't know. It was touching to me. And for Elizabeth, who uses this, it's where when you do research, you go out and you find stuff and you can use it for your novel. And this, I said, I got to put this in. It was hopefully something that illuminated Elizabeth's own life when she saw these two crosses. And she saw lots, and I did too, saw lots of crosses with lots of stories. And originally I thought about telling this as nonfiction. In fact, a mutual friend of ours, Suzanne Strumpick Shea, I went to her when I originally came up with this idea, and I said, a friend who's a novelist and a nonfiction writer, and said, hey, I got this great idea, do you want it? And I told her about it, she said, it's a great idea, but it's yours. And I'm not a nonfiction writer, so I told it as a novel. Other questions? Yep. The question of empathetic imagination. We all have to have it. If you're a novelist or a poet or a nonfiction writer, you have to have it. You have to write about other people's lives. You can't just write about your own life, and especially for a novelist. You have to write about many other people's lives, okay? You know, I'm a white male of a certain age and certain socioeconomic and whatever. If I can only write about what I know, it's very limiting and very boring. It's not only going to make he's already bored. It's not only going to make my writing boring, but it's going to bore my readers. And so every character you write about is not going to be yourself. Most of them are not going to be yourself, so you have to get into the characters. How do you do that is your question. I said one thing is to do your research. Okay? When I wrote this book, number one, I read several books on roadside memorials, people that went to them. I looked at blogs that had roadside memorials. There's a whole, you know, subculture of roadside memorials across the country. And not only I read books, but then I started to stop at them. And then I went across country and I looked at one after the other. I took pictures, I got out, I looked at them. I said, my goodness, why would anybody do this? It's kind of weird and morbid, I thought. But after a while I thought, you know, this is people telling their stories of their dead loved ones, fathers, brothers, children. And they want to put something up there. And what they felt and what I heard is that one of my characters said, what about a cemetery, you know? And another character says, cemeteries are cold and distant. These things are right there. And these things are where your loved ones was, in these cases, last alive. So by getting out of the car 101 times, you'd stop and you'd say, this would be like what it would feel like. Okay? And at one point, Elizabeth in this story gets out of the car, climbs a fence in her business suit, rips her stocking, bloodies her leg, climbs down the other side to these two crosses side by side, and she picks up the stuff, and then she lies there, and she tries to imagine what it was like to be there when this young couple crashed and died. And then the parents at one point saying, we got to do this. Because not every parent, most parents don't do it. Most loved ones don't do this. Otherwise, there'd be crosses everywhere. And she said, what would make a parent go down in the basement, saw the boards, nail them together, paint them, bring them out, have some kind of ceremony? How would you do that? And what would it mean? So I think you do your research and then you try to put yourself really there and say, what would it be like? Okay? Other questions? Yes. Yes. I mean, if you're a novelist, you've got to be always on the lookout for stories. You could ask any novelist here, any person writing a novel here, you have to be on the lookout for stories. You know, and you got to, I have like 20 story ideas on my computer with anywhere from 2 pages to 30 or 40 pages written about stories. Most of those I won't live long enough to write, okay? And they'll die with me. But we are filled with wanting to tell stories. I am, as a novelist. I'm constantly looking for stories. And I tell my undergraduates, and I tell my graduate students, you have to train your mind to think of not just, oh, that'd be an interesting story, but how could I shape it? How could I form it? What could I do? And when you get an interesting story, don't let it just come in one ear and out the other. You've got to sit down and jot it down. And you may say, 90% of the time, nothing will come of that. But that 1% or 5% or 10%, like resting places or soul catcher, it'll develop. Yes. Yes.
What is your process in terms of, let's say, hitting a wall? You know, let's say you're going at a pace and then suddenly you feel like you're not quite sure where to go with your novel.
Are you talking about writer's block or are you talking about... Well, yeah. Number one, I've never had writer's block. Okay, and what I mean by, I've written badly. I've struggled sometimes. Some days go by and I've only cut things. Some days go by and I've added nothing. Some days go by, but I sit my butt in this chair for 4 or 5 hours or 3 hours and I get something done. I go back and review pages, okay? So I do come many times. I mean, more ideas have come to me than I've actually finished as far as novels. This is my 8th book. I just finished up my 9th book. There are numerous ones that are sitting somewhere in hyperspace or in a burnt their ashes now or something. But yeah.
Does the germ of the idea for the novel come from experience, or are you really? I struggle with the idea that I can't just rest. I can't just make it up.
Ideas. Ideas for novels? Are you saying ideas for novels? Are you saying, where does an idea for a novel come from? Okay, lots of places. Some from other books. Beautiful Assassin came from, I came down the stairs in my house in Guilford, and I had the History Channel on, and they said something about a female sniper in Russia who killed 306 Germans. I said, what? Run that by me again? And it was like 30 seconds on the end of a sniper special on History Channel. I said, wow, I didn't know that. I'll just say two. The first novel came, I was up in Maine fly fishing with a couple of friends, and I was looking at a topo map and I flipped it over on the back. There was a mention, not very well known, on Moosehead Lake, there was a German POW camp. You know, Americans ran it and had German POW prisoners. And I said, I found that very fascinating. This one I said, I came up with it by stopping at this one roadside memorial in New Hampshire. On, I think it's Route 7 that cuts across New Hampshire and Vermont. So, yes, we're almost coming? Yes.
I was just wondering, because in California we have those all over the place.
Yeah. A bicycle.
To do a white bicycle.
Huh, I didn't know that.
So I was just going to ask you, did you ever come across those, but maybe not? Maybe it's a California.
I've never come across a bicycle. I've come across lots of different things. I've come across, and I have like about 100 photos I still have on my hard drive that I could send to you. But I remember there were lots of different kinds of things. You know, there was a biker guy that got killed somewhere in the mountains of New Mexico, where this novel ends, by the way. And there were a bunch of beer bottles that his buddies had left for him. And I thought, well, this is just what he needed, more of this. But that's where they remembered him. And there was another story about 30 miles away where there was this picture of this beautiful woman, a Latina woman who had died. Her picture was laminated, and there was a guitar and stuffed teddy bears. I mean, they just put everything there. And I looked up her name, okay? And the irony of this story was, when I looked it up, she caused the death of six other people by crashing into them. And I said, there's a story. There's an interesting story, too. So, other, maybe one more, two more? Okay.
How much do you let one theme drive the direction of the story? So obviously, religion is something that keeps creeping up. And then you have all of these influences from these roadside graves you're visiting. So is that tough? Do you feel like you get pulled in a lot of directions?
Yeah. Yeah, I'll be frank. I'm an atheist. I'm a searching atheist. Many of my novels are, two of my novels are about priests. This is a very spiritual novel. I believe deeply in spirituality. I'm an atheist, so I have a hard job believing the kind of formal, traditional kinds of things. Elizabeth is closer to me in this, as a character, but she had to be led to a different place. Okay, I wish she could grab me and pull me along, but that's, you know, she had to be pulled along in this direction that she's fighting and kicking against, because she's much more rational. Her husband, by the way, is a Catholic and a believer, and that's the way he handles the death of their child. She doesn't. She handles it by drinking and throwing herself into this work that I read from the first chapter. Yeah. One more question? We'll finish up. Thank you very much.